But there is a fundamental difference between Islam and extremism. Islam is a great religion, observed peacefully and devoutly by over a billion people in our world.
His teachings are good and peaceful. The face of terror is not the true faith of Islam. That's not what Islam is all about. Islam is peace.
Who set threats on you? So we can invade their country and take their wives and war booty.
The hadith of the Prophet Muhammad emphasizes the duty of care we owe one another.
Because you're walking through a Muslim area, you're walking through a Muslim area dressed like a fag, mate. You need to get out of here. Yeah, get out of here quicker then.
So during this special month, let us also celebrate the diversity that contributes to Britain's strength. Muslims make a huge contribution to Britain's success.
And now we find out that the homegrown terrorist who plotted it all was on welfare payments for 19 years. He never worked a day and has cost us millions.
And Muslims make an incredibly valuable contribution to our country.
Young Muslims say they want to turn Buckingham Palace into a mosque. CNN's Nick Robertson spoke to their leader, who is determined to see the UK become an Islamic state.
Ramadan teaches patience and humility, reminds us of our shared moral universe and our obligations to others.
Into the World Trade Center. It was a jet, it was a very large plane, it was going fast, it went past the Ritz-Carlton Hotel that's being built in Battery Park, it went, flew right past it, almost hit it, and then went in.
Holy shit.
Oh my God!
Oh
my God!
Oh my God!
Oh my God!
Oh my God!
Oh my God!
American people were appalled and outraged. At last Tuesday's attacks, and so were Muslims all across the world.
East Jerusalem today, among jubilant Palestinians that the United States had been subject to this attack. What are we to make of that, Jennifer? Yasser Arafat may issue this condemnation. Look at this. We're seeing people applauding, clapping, smiling, happy to know that thousands of Americans have died in this sneak attack. And there you see a V for victory sign held up to the camera.
And Muslims and nations were just appalled and could not believe what we saw on our TV screens.
Muslims rejoicing in the carnage. They call themselves the Revolution Muslim. Today on their website, they called the alleged shooter, Major Hassan, an officer and a gentleman. They said, quote, "We love you." At the same time, they called the slain soldiers terrorists who are in, quote, eternal hellfire. These men are radicals, but they are also Americans, believe it or not, who praise Osama bin Laden and celebrate the 9/11 attacks.
When we think of Islam, we think of a faith that brings comfort to a billion people around the world. It's a great country because we share the same values of respect and dignity and human worth.
Their goal, nothing short of Muslim domination of the United Kingdom, if not the world.
This poster is basically showing how we will transform Buckingham Palace into a local mosque for the Muslims.
And what happens to the Queen?
Well, the Queen, she has a choice. She can either become Muslim or she can leave the country.
This man, Amjad Chowdhury, is their leader. He demands Islamic law, known as Sharia, to be the law of the land.
The terrorists are traitors to their own faith.
He describes the 9/11 attackers as the Magnificent 19.
Islam is a peaceful and tolerant religion, and the acts of these people are wholly contrary to the teachings of the Quran.
This is London, 9:47 on a midsummer morning. The terrified voices are those of mourning commuters. Some of them terribly wounded. These images captured by a passerby moments after the explosion. The terrorists struck one of the city's most reassuring everyday symbols, a London bus, the number 30 from Hackney to Marble Arch. What many remember is the extraordinary noise of the blast, rising above the noise of rush hour. Shards of metal, the blood of the wounded, blasted onto nearby buildings.
I have great respect for the Islamic religion.
These acts and violence against innocents violate the fundamental tenets of the Islamic faith.
It is important for Western countries to avoid impeding Muslim citizens from practicing religion as they see fit. Islam is not part of the problem in combating violent extremism. It is an important part of promoting peace.
Ya ummat Muhammad, سيقول حتى الحجر يا مسلم هذا يهودي من خلفي تعال وقاعدة ونحن نقطعها والله لا نقطعها أيها اليهود الله أكبر الله أكبر.
We will convey our deep appreciation for the Islamic faith, which has done so much over the centuries to shake the world.
Taliban militants say they've executed two women who worked as prostitutes on a US base. As you see in this video, the burqa clad women got into a car after the Taliban militants opened fire. Well, these pictures of the execution taken by an Associated Press television news.
I also know civilization's debt to Islam and places of peaceful contemplation.
Islam is a peaceful and tolerant religion, and the acts of these people are wholly contrary to the teachings of the Quran.
UK, you will pay!
UK, you will pay!
UK, you will pay!
UK, you will pay!
7-7 on its way!
7-7 on its way!
7-7 on its way!
7-7 on its way!
بهترین دین است در اسلام است یکی سوی مشهد بعد در نگاه اسلام بعد باید اون مگم
Islam is a great religion, observed peacefully and devoutly by over a billion people in our world.
Molenbeek's police station is located hardly 100 meters away. Many police officers are afraid that the state no longer wields authority here.
The hadith of the Prophet Muhammad emphasizes the duty of care. Muslims make a huge contribution to Britain's success.
Oh my God!
Chowdhury supports Osama bin Laden and justifies the 9/11 attacks.
What Chowdhury is implying is that how radicalization evolves here in Britain and in Europe will in some part be a model for what the United States can expect.
And Muslims make an incredibly valuable contribution to our country.
No, probably we will fight you off. Yeah.
If that's what you want, I don't understand what good that does.
I just need to know if I'm going to be arrested or not, or if you just thought it was a good idea that we walk away. If you're telling me that we're going to get arrested, that's what I need to know. Are you telling me that we're going to get arrested?
I'm not telling you they're going to be arrested, but you know you are a danger to the public safety. You're disorderly.
I would assume, 200 angry Muslim children throwing bottles would be more of a threat than a few guys with signs.
It's a great country because we share the same values of respect and dignity and human worth.
ولا يعلمون أن الشعب الفلسطيني قد طور من موته ومن بحثه على الموت ولذلك أصبح الموت عند الشعب الفلسطيني صناعة. تجيده النساء
في سبيل الله
Chowdhury's strategy is to pit Muslims against everyone else to create tension. One of those arrested was this woman, Malika Alaroud. Her website praised Osama bin Laden.
Most Muslims love Osama like I love him myself.
Since our founding, American Muslims have enriched the United States.
Now, intelligence officials tell CNN that a French atomic scientist charged last month with associating with terrorists was participating in Malika Alaroud's website.
Young Muslims of both sexes, between 15 and 25 years of age, are becoming increasingly radicalized. They reject Western values.
Islam is not part of the problem in combating violent extremism. It is an important part of promoting peace.
The hadith of the Prophet Muhammad emphasizes the duty of care.
Islam is a peaceful and tolerant religion.
Its teachings are good and peaceful. Islam is peace.
Democracy and Islam can flourish alongside one another.
Has been pouring out of huge holes in the upper portions of the building.
It does not appear that there's any kind of an effort up there yet. Now remember, oh my God.
That looks like a second plane.
This is London, 9:47 on a midsummer morning. Those sitting upstairs took the full force of the devastating blast. Shards of metal, the blood of the wounded, blasted onto nearby buildings. The terrified voices are those of mourning commuters. Some of them terribly wounded.
I've never seen any, it looks like a movie. I saw a large plane, like a jet, going immediately, headed directly into the World Trade Center. It just flew into the other tower, coming from south to north. I watched the plane fly into the World Trade Center. It was a jet. It was a very large plane. It was going fast. It went past the Ritz-Carlton Hotel that's being built in Battery Park. It went flew right past it, almost hit it.
Oh my God! Oh my God!
What I would like to talk to you about today concerns a very well-known following which has been misconceived as the fastest growing religion in the world. a religion of peace, tolerance, and understanding, but all the while the truth being a religion that undermines our democratic freedoms. A doctrine which threatens our own personal safety, our culture, and the laws which have held this great nation and many other Western countries together peacefully for hundreds of years. A delusional mindset which stands to destroy the very fabric of our great society if its agenda is not addressed, studied, and exposed. The movement which I'm referring to is, of course, Islam. Before I begin, this video is not in any way intended to be a religious video, intending to proselytize or to be non-factually biased. The purpose of this video is not only to factually examine the core Islamic texts of the Quran, thus forcing its twisted and medieval ideology into the spotlight and out of its subversive seclusion, but to demonstrate just how dangerous and detrimental venerated Muslim cleric teachings are to our own society, and furthermore how completely obtrusive, repugnant, and contradictory Islamic law is to our own British laws. It could be persistently argued without a doubt that the UK has the highest concentrated number of Muslim immigrants and citizens, while being the most virulent in any of the world's Western countries. At this point in time, we are seeing our own liberal laws allow extremist Muslims to declare violence on UK citizens and on the very government that provides them sanctuary and so generously provides welfare to many of their own families. Nowhere in the history of the UK have we seen congregations of men in organized marches proclaim hateful remarks such as, "May God curse the Queen, British soldiers burn in hell," without fear of reprisal and punishment. There is no secret that Muslims such as these have and are taking advantage of our own laws and our passive way of life to further their own agendas. These men not only represent the minority of extremist Muslims, but the total majority of Muslim citizens in the UK today. It's no secret. We're seeing it happen even more frequently than before, and many of us are baffled why not only our government is allowing this, but what is the endgame or agenda for Islam? What I'm about to say is not intended to be racist, as Islam is not bound by any ethnicity. This fact overrules the common misconception that people like myself are racist. We are not. We are firmly opposed to the Quran, Islam, and the teaching of Muhammad and Islamic clerics. The UK and myself welcomes immigrants of all countries, and I enjoy seeing an ethnically diverse Britain. But let it be said, my issue is with Islam. What I propose may be shocking to most people today, but in light of the current geopolitical climate, there's no denying that our own way of life is under attack. It could be said that actual war has been declared on us. As a patriotic and proud citizen of this country, my proposition and the purpose of this video is not only to bring forth a constitutionally based legal inquiry into Islamic values and teachings, the doctrine, and the mindset of Islam, but to determine whether or not Islam is welcome in this country altogether. Furthermore, I also wish to raise an inquiry into the loyalty of our present lawmakers and their intentions for a freer and democratic UK. My proposition: I propose that if the Quran is found to be a danger to UK citizens, their way of life, and more importantly, our laws, then ultimately we must push for the complete ban of the Quran and the practice of Islam altogether in this country. The following will explain in detail why I feel the way I do, and are urging our government to take final action against such a virulent movement. Firstly, let us not fall into the popular misconception trap that Islam is in itself a religion. If, at best, Islam should be more closely classified as a cult. Proof lies with our good friend, the dictionary. A cult is accurately described as the following: a system of religious veneration and devotion, with a misplaced or excessive admiration for a particular person or thing, with practices regarded as strange or sinister, a quasi-religious organization using devious psychological techniques to gain and control adherents. Behaviors such as death warrants for those who leave the faith, regional banning on any religious text other than the Quran, compulsive obsessions with adding the words "Peace be upon him" or PBUH, each and every time a Muslim mentions Muhammad's name, or self-destructive tendencies, namely suicide bombings, at the behest of a religious type figure, all point to the fact that Islam is indeed a cult. Now, as I mentioned before, this video is not intended for a religious debate, but it is worth mentioning the following. It may be argued that other religions have similar values, a messiah type figure, or the expectation of one. What keeps Islam apart is its own laws that allow itself to be a quote-unquote religion with divisive tendencies. Its cultish behavior is evident as ex-Muslims are excommunicated from the faith, and more often than not, their lives are threatened if they should ever speak out against Islam. Islam is not only a cult, but in fact a mob-ruled totalitarian political system cleverly and insidiously disguised in the cloak of religion. But why would Islam be classified as a religion in the UK, even if its own core values are malicious to UK citizens, much the same way as Nazi philosophy was to Great Britain? The reason Islam will not declare itself publicly at this time as a political organization or a political ethos is simple. The reason is because it can hide behind our religious-based hate crime and constitutional laws, which permit freedom of worship, even though its core doctrine opposes such liberties that we take for granted. Ironically, these primary UK laws would ultimately oppose such a fascist and dangerous ideology like Islam if it was ever to be declared publicly that it is not a religion. We have seen such groups in the past who have tried to enforce their twisted agenda, such as eugenics, racial power, and due to our own diligence, the aggressors have failed miserably. The following facts about Islam may give you a proper insight into why it is in fact a mass cult and a political system with its own contrary laws to that of the United Kingdom. The following has been researched in detail to prove that the Quran, and more importantly, Muslim clerical teachings do not abide with the British law, and to expose this cult for what it really is. It must be noted that in the world of Islam, the cleric is the utmost authority on the Quran and Islamic law. Never is he to be criticized or even questioned. In the world of Islam, the cleric is God. You may be wondering exactly what is the purpose of mentioning some of the facts that I'm about to say. Muslims revere Muhammad, their primary prophet, as the perfect man and are encouraged to live a life exactly how he did. He is an excellent model of conduct. He demonstrates an exalted standard of character. These disturbing points will give you some insight into the nature of the beast. Please use the attached links, which contain Quranic verses and articles supporting my claim, to gain a more detailed insight into this cult. Warning, the following content is not suitable for children. Please remove them from the room before continuing this video. It is common knowledge and happily accepted by all Muslims that Muhammad did in fact have a child bride. Her name was Aisha. What most don't know is that Muhammad never waited until she was of contemporary acceptable age to consummate the marriage. Aisha at the time of marriage was 6. Historians state that Aisha was no more than 9 when her new husband took her virginity. Muhammad at the time of consummation was at a grand age of 54. And Muslims today refer to the marriage as a beautiful union. It is even quoted in the Quran that Aisha would play with her dolls and toys whenever Muhammad was not copulating with her. In fact, it is noted in the Quran that Muhammad's wives and maids spent more time washing semen stains from his clothes and bedsheets than actually praying to their God. It is a documented fact, not only in the Quran, but in historical chronicles, that Muhammad not only molested his young wife constantly, but also raped young slave children who he had captured during his holy wars. And Muslims still find it hard to understand today why, after his death, many apostatized from Islam after witnessing the hypocrisy and evil nature of Muhammad. It is no secret that the primary Muslim prophet Muhammad was indeed a pedophile. This could contribute to a stigma of pedophilia surrounding the so-called religion. In fact, pedophilia was and is a way of life for many Muslims, especially in countries like Pakistan and Afghanistan, Though the government deems such acts as illegal, the law is seldom enforced, and more often than not, the courts turn a blind eye. This disgusting act is known as bachabazi, or boys for pleasure. In the aforementioned regions, it is commonly practiced today by Muslim men. The bachabazi boys are often dressed up as little girls and forced to dance before being forced upon by much older pederasts. Don't believe me? Then please refer to the award-winning documentary, The Dancing Boys of Afghanistan. The video will give you a detailed account into the depraved, Muslim-oriented ritual. According to many knowledgeable sources on the topic, a Muslim man has the right to have sexual intercourse and play with a young boy if he has not yet grown a beard. This excerpt is taken from a website detailing the phenomenon. Their plight is not unlike that of a woman forced into sexual performance or prostitution, who also have a difficult time being accepted into society and finding work after their ordeal. Bachabazi boys often return to the industry even after they have left because they have no other means to support themselves. Women who have been forced into commercial sex often do the same. Perhaps so many similarities exist because bachabazi feminizes these boys in order to degrade them. By forcing them to perform in women's clothes and by raping them, this tradition not only seeks to humiliate these boys for the pleasure of wealthy men, but also to reinforce the idea that women are inferior and for a boy to have feminine affections is degrading for him. It's a window into the severe gender inequality that pervades Afghanistan and Islam. The Quran even quotes Muhammad condoning his men to kiss and suck the tongues of little boys. No less than 20 Islamic sources, such as the hadiths of Ahmad bin Hanbal, relay that Muhammad used to suck on the tongues of boys and girls. Despite the Quran's virulent stance on homosexuality and cross-dressing, it is a known fact among many scholars that Muhammad himself may well have been a homosexual and dabbled in cross-dressing. Sahih al-Bukhari 2442 states that Muhammad said, "The revelation of God does not come to me when I am in the garment, mert in Arabic, of any other woman except Aisha." Hard to believe, but the Quran contains over 30 verses confirming Muhammad's hypocrisy, citing Muhammad did indeed wear women's clothing occasionally. In the Quran, Sahih Muslim refers to Muhammad wearing Aisha's mert being solely used only for women. Another verse by Mazen Ahmad said, "I saw the Prophet, Muhammad, sucking on the tongue of Al-Hassan, son of Ali, for no tongue that the Prophet sucked on will be tormented in hell." It has even been suggested by venerated theologian and Muslim revivalist Abdul Allah Maududi that homosexuality will be permitted once arriving in heaven. This comment leaves much to doubt about Muhammad's so-called words of conviction. Abdul Allah said, "If wine is prohibited in this world and allowed in paradise, the same will happen with homosexuality." This quotation is hypocritical of Islam's stance on homosexuality. In fact, so is the issue of lesbianism, as it is never mentioned, not once, in the Quran. Muhammad never seemed to have a problem with it, and neither omitted or submitted anything relating to female homosexuality. Could it have been that he secretly enjoyed the act? Only Muhammad knew. In conclusion, Islam's stance on homosexuality and cross-dressing is completely hypocritical. The sex slave industry is predominant around Islam. Muhammad stated that it is permissible to have as many concubines as he wanted, woman or child. Hence why today we are witnessing an emergence of Muslim men gang-raping women, kidnapping and prostituting out young girls to other Muslim men. A large part of Sharia is dedicated to the practice. The ironic part is that Muhammad was a rampant slave owner, slave trader, who also captured slaves in battle. He raped his slaves and he instructed his men to do the same. There are more verses in the Quran making sure Muslim men know they can keep women as sex slaves than teaching them to pray 5 times a day. Sexual assault and rape gravitates around Islam. In Muslim society, a raped woman must have 4 male witnesses to bring a penalty to her assailant, or if the rapist confesses. Such accusations are almost always quashed and are rarely met with any prosecution. But here's the kicker. Women who allege rape without the benefit of the act having been witnessed by 4 men who subsequently develop a conscience are actually confessing to having sex. If they or the accused happens to be married or even not, then it is considered to be adultery. In the Arab states, adultery carries the penalty of death by either beheading, stoning, or hanging. Muhammad's marriage to a 6-year-old child is a taboo subject in Islam, and most Muslims often adamantly claim Aisha was now 14 when she lost her virginity. This is an absolute lie, and still doesn't make the Prophet sound any more holy. The truth is that Islam now condones child bride marriages now as young as 1 year old. A recent article reported that a Saudi cleric has now officially decreed that all men are permitted to marry any Muslim child, whether she be 6, 9, or even 1. It has been decreed that it is the will of God. It has been reported that a growing number of British Muslim girls have been tricked by family members, forcing them into receiving female circumcision, a barbaric medieval act that Muslims say is an obligation to Islam. The reason behind it? Cleanliness, neatness of appearance, and the increased sexual pleasure for the man. This excruciatingly painful, disgusting, and brutal act has now hit our shores and are organized by cutting parties facilitated by local and foreign women who have flown into the UK to perform the gruesome act. Although unable to give consent, many girls are compliant when they have the procedure carried out, believing that they'll be outcasts if they are not cut. The mothers believe they are doing the best for their daughters. Few have any idea of the lifelong of hurt it can involve or the medical implications. One study among Egyptian women found 50% of women who had undergone female circumcision endured sex rather than enjoying it. Despite Muslims' claims that their Prophet was a peaceful and loving man, Muhammad was a barbaric, psychopathic, warmongering marauder who plagued the Saudi Arabian Peninsula, ransacking and raiding caravans. Mindless violence under the guise of religion, which led to murder, rape, pillage, and slavery, and consequently creating and imposing the jizya, a taxation only imposed on non-Muslims as a way of tribute and coercion into joining Islam, a practice that is still enforced today. Muhammad organized 65 military campaigns in the last 10 years of his life to wipe out any opposition to Islam. There are more verses and stories in the Quran depicting Muhammad's bloodthirsty nature than any verses of peace and forgiveness. A favorite pastime for him and his men, before capturing and enslaving the women and children, for his own sexual gratification of course, was to barbarically cut the heads of his enemies. And Muslims call him a peaceful and holy man. You may have heard many critics calling Islam warring, but you never knew exactly why it is so. The reason behind such a violent mindset is the fact that the Quran is a hateful document and a manual for war. All those who are either the unbelievers, Christians and Jews, or oppose Muhammad and Allah are to be slain. The proof lies with the following verses taken directly from the Quran. Please note, the following content is quite extended. Feel free to browse through them quickly if you please. There are hundreds of verses and stories quoting Muhammad's bloodshed, which only proves that Islam and the Quran is a menace to society. There is no secret that women in Islamic countries are often treated poorly by the law in contrast to Western women. There is a delusional mindset that women in Islamic countries have as much rights as their male counterparts. This is far from the truth. To give you an insight into the male chauvinistic and unequal nature of Islam, here are some examples of Muhammad's vision for women. The Quran condones bigamy, or polygamy if you will, and is a way of life in Islamic states and now the UK. There is no secret that Muslims can have up to 4 wives. The credibility of this number is uncertain, as their own prophet had as many as 13 to 22 wives, which is of course breaking his own rules. But more to the point, it is illegal in the British Isles for any non-Muslim to have more than one lawfully married spouse, unless, that is of course, you marry in an Islamic nikah ceremony to avoid breaking such laws. Consequently, add up how many welfare recipients can claim for each spouse, and you have an inflated budget for an un-British male chauvinistic medieval law. The question is, why should the taxpayer have to support a man who wishes to have more than one wife? Just another fact to prove that Islam and Britain do not mix. The Quran is discriminatory, racist, and it permits lying. Islam forbids Muslims to make friends with Christians or Jews, otherwise known as the unbelievers, nor to allow the marriage of a Muslim with a non-Muslim. The Quran is absolutely clear on this issue. According to the Quran, it is the legal right of Muslims to deceive non-Muslims. The key word is taqiyah. Quran 5:51 says, "O you who believe, do not take the Jews and the Christians for friends. They are friends of each other." But it is commonly taught that through obscurity they can become a friend. The word taqiyah means to trick and to deceive. This law can be invoked if a Muslim should ever take the stand and give testimony. For example, if a Muslim witnessed another Muslim raping a non-Muslim girl, according to the Quran, he is permitted to lie to protect his fellow Muslim. A Muslim can take an oath to please or win someone's confidence, but Allah has set them free from their oaths. Another verse specifically singles out the Jews and calls for their death. Allah's apostle said, "The hour will not be established until you fight the Jews, and the stone behind him, which a Jew will be hiding, will say, 'O Muslim, there is a Jew hiding behind me, so kill him.'" Bukhari 52:177. The aforementioned verses only prove that you cannot trust Muslims or the false rhetoric they spout about peace and treaty with non-Muslims. The fatwa is a decree set forth by a Muslim cleric. It is always referred to by Muslims as a peaceful declaration made by a cleric similar to that of a Catholic papal bull. But the truth is quite the contrary. In using the Quran, a cleric can proclaim or decree any law or command which may and most often will result in honor killings, death warrants, or even war. The most famous fatwa of our time was imposed on author Salman Rushdie after he published his book, The Satanic Verses. Rushdie was forced into hiding as he received many death threats and attempts to murder him. In Sharia law, Muslims are exempt from Sharia law punishment or death sentence if they kill a non-Muslim in the name of Allah. This most always comes under the ruling as self-defense or jihad, but such a gray area is ever probed. Our Western foreign policies have never seen eye to eye with Islam, and so we are seen as an enemy, or better known as infidels. It is their Muslim right to exterminate and oppress any person who may be a threat to their establishment. Of course, as they will profusely state, in self-defense. Muslim clerics are notorious for imposing the aforementioned fatwa or death sentence on anyone who quote-unquote insults Islam. Islam is so afraid of Muslims discovering the diabolical nature of its ethos that it imposes immediate death sentences on those who should even debate the teachings of the Quran. Such a mindset has led to stonings, beheadings, and international death warrants on respected figures. Islam forbids adoption. In the Arab states, there are millions of neglected and starving homeless children without parents or care. Because of Islam, these poor souls are subjected to a demeaning life of hardship due to one man's quote-unquote vision. Muhammad declared that adoption should be banned in Islam because he lusted after his own daughter-in-law, who was married to his adopted son. Muhammad forced his adopted son to divorce his wife so he could marry her instead. He justified his actions as a commandment inspired by God. From then on, Muslims could no longer adopt. A Muslim man has the right to divorce, talaq, a woman by simply saying, "I divorce you," only 3 times. Effectively, the woman has 3 months to win back her man. After that period, idat, the marriage is dissolved, and the woman is out on the street. The Quran commands Muslims to fight against non-Muslims. This falls under the jihad category. Muslims are taught that non-Muslims are the lowest creatures on earth and they should be ridiculed. Throughout the Quran, the true nature of Muhammad is reflected in the teachings and verses in the text. Such beautiful and peaceful verses include, "Slay the idolaters, cut off their limbs on opposite sides, take them captives, and besiege them and lie in wait for them in every ambush." Honor killings are the act of revenge when a family member, usually a sister, a mother, or a daughter, brings shame to the family. Muslim communities often operate in enclaves and tightly knit neighborhoods. If a Muslim girl was to be seen holding a non-Muslim's hand or even kiss, it could bring forth a close family member to carry out a gruesome violation onto her, or at worst, death. People may wonder why domestic violence is so prevalent throughout Islam. The reason being is that the Quran enforces the rule that a wife should be subservient and obsequious to the point of being a voiceless slave. A Muslim man is allowed to beat his wife into submission, but the beating must cease if the woman complies. Beating is the last resort after peaceful acts such as coercion, verbal abuse, and abandonment. Contrary to what the Quran may say about respecting other religions, it's a fallacy. The ideology of Islam preaches zero tolerance against other religions, whether it be Coptic Christians in Egypt, Buddhists in Thailand, or even homosexuals in their own country. After all, such people are considered to be unbelievers, and what fate shall be that of the unbeliever? In an Islamic country, you are banned to carry any other religious text that is not the Quran. Islam is insecure about its own teachings. A British flight attendant was not allowed to carry her Bible when working a long-haul flight to Saudi Arabia. She was given the ultimatum to change her shift or resign. Not only is Islam intolerant to other religions, it now condemns the day of international love, Valentine's Day. A recent Malaysian state sermon declared that inviting someone to be my Valentine will incur the wrath of God. So much for a religion of love. In an Islamic country, you can't leave Islam. It is forbidden, as it is the unthinkable to even consider the idea to apostatize from the cult. The Quran and Islamic states leave no room for debate or even freedom to choose one's religion without fear of reprisal. Hence why Muslims will always state, the reason why Islam is the fastest growing religion is because it's so convicting. Even during Muhammad's reign of terror, anyone caught criticizing him or Islam soon became victims of a most gruesome violation. To even write a simple poem or create a song voicing your concerns about the cult would be met with a cowardly attacker raping and killing you in the middle of the night. Hence why Muslims feel so convicted by the Quran. Conviction by the sword, no doubt. A reminder once again, this video is not intended to be an instrument to debate religion, but to give an insight into the perverted nature of Islam. There are literally hundreds of delusional and perturbing verses in the Quran that would exceed the time limits of this video. Instead, please refer to the following link in regards to further demented and unscientific insights written by Muhammad, contained predominantly in the Quranic Hadiths. Personally, if I didn't know better, Muhammad could have possibly written the Quran under the influence of hashish, as it was a common pastime in that era. The actual derived meaning of the word assassin comes from hashish or hashisha. So in conclusion to these facts, the point I'm trying to make here is, do you think Islam has a place in British or Western society? I'll continue my point. What is Islam really? People can make the mistake of believing Islam is just another cult, but the truth and its agenda is far more shocking. As mentioned before, Islam is indeed a political establishment, but with an agenda which is secret to most UK citizens. Islam's final act and end goal is worldwide conversion and subjugation of every man, woman, and child to Islam under Quranic law. After all, the true meaning of Islam is submission. As beautiful and peaceful as it may sound, and as many times as we heard political figures spout rhetoric about its beauty and mystique,
its teachings are good and peaceful.
The true meaning of the word does not derive warm, fuzzy feelings of spirituality or obedience to God. Islam itself means submission to the law, the Quranic law, the law set by Muhammad, an evil and wicked marauding pedophile whose only goal was to control the masses, impose his form of taxation, otherwise known as the halal or jizya. A malevolent author of the Quran, a dangerous doctrine of oppression, child molestation, discriminatory taxation, and subjugation, which he fondly referred to as submission. His law, which was devised hundreds of years ago, was written for one single purpose, to oppress whatever nation would convert to his religion. This Quranic verse sums up the quote-unquote beautiful side of submission, or Islam. When you meet your enemies who are polytheists, which includes Christians, invite them to three courses of action. If they respond to any one of these, you also accept it and withhold yourself from doing them any harm. Invite them to accept Islam. If they respond to you, accept it from them and desist from fighting against them. If they refuse to accept Islam, demand from them the jizya. If they agree to pay, accept it from them and hold off your hands. If they refuse to pay the tax, seek Allah's help and fight them. So what does this mean for us? By now you're probably shocked by what has been shown to you, but it's not over yet. Surely our laws will ultimately protect us from such an insidious and anti-democratic doctrine. After all, our forefathers have fought such regimes to keep us safe. Think again. In Islam, it is preached there are two houses. The House of Islam, which many people believe is submission, or inaccurately translated to peace. And then there is the second house. This house is where the majority of UK citizens fall under. Islam calls it the kafir, or unbeliever, but most closely translated from the Quran in Arabic, it is the house of war. So in definition, this applies to all those who do not believe in Allah, the Quran, or that Muhammad was the true prophet, or those who know nothing of it, or those who have outrightly and rejected the faith and oppose Islam. I proudly fall into that category. War being the key word in this scenario. Muhammad once said that it is permissible to lie to the enemy in times of war. Since Muhammad was constantly at war with everyone, lying became a way of life for Muslims and still is today. When media groups, journalists, and law courts question the true intentions of Islam, a Muslim is allowed to lie to cover his behind. So how can we trust Muslims if they're indoctrinated with this mindset? The answer is, we can't. Please read the following link about condonation of lying in Islam. The article elaborates in detail about takia and how Muslims use it today. If Muslims were successful in converting non-Muslims to Islam, how would they control the masses? What you may or may not know is that Islam itself administers a particular law onto its own citizens, a law completely opposed to our own liberal and just statutes. Muslims' Islamic law must be followed with complete devotion lest they suffer punishment of death. The domineering law which rules all Muslims, which I'm referring to, is called Sharia law. What is Sharia law? It is the core obligation of every Muslim to usher in and ultimately enforce Sharia law on every person in this world. Completely contrary to our own way of life and our own laws, it is a totalitarian fascist ethos which was born out of the Dark Ages. An age of beheadings, excruciating stoning executions, barbaric removal of limbs, inhumane animal culling practices, and anti-Western sex crime laws. The aforementioned Islam 101 covers only a fraction of what Sharia law permits. Barbaric laws which were created around 609 AD, today these laws still exist. Such laws include on-the-spot divorce, stoning for adultery, permission for child molestation, of course, if they're married, the list goes on. The taboo subject of honor killing is seldom investigated and is among Muslim communities overlooked. It is believed to be in the best interest of the Muslim community that any act taken to suppress anti-Quranic law would be deemed permissible. The ultimate goal for Muslims in the UK today and around the world is to establish a worldwide legal system in which Sharia law dominates above all. Don't believe me? I challenge you to ask any Muslim in the UK or in any Western country and ask them two questions. One, is Sharia law the same as Western democratic law and can it coexist together? Two, given the choice, which law would you ultimately have imposed in the UK? I think you can guess what their answer will be. The point is, Muslims in the UK may enjoy our Western democratic laws and its freedom to choose, but if Sharia law ever sought fruition overnight in our great land, as Muslims, they would not object even in the slightest. Currently, there are 85 Sharia law courts in the UK today. It has now become a divided nation. With such courts in place, any Muslim that is arrested and charged with a crime that violates our British laws can enter a plea exercising their right to use Sharia law, thus having their sentences quashed and record expunged. For example, an 18-year-old Muslim man who was married a 12-year-old Muslim girl and had sexual relations with her can plead Sharia law and the courts will not be able to prosecute him. Muslims will virtually become untouchable. As insidious as it is divisive, Sharia law is an anathema to our modern UK laws, which have served us well for centuries and hopefully more to come. As our nation progresses, we are able to learn from our past mistakes and enact new laws to protect its citizens for the best. Sharia law does not, it has not, and never will. Instead, it persistently leads its followers darker into a world of hate, blindness, and oppression. Every year, new Muslim laws are created, mostly by clerics, accurately interpreting from the Quran, which further subjugate their citizens, making them a fearful nation of devout followers. This excerpt, which explains the myth about Islam being a democracy, is taken from thereligionofpeace.com for your reference. The myth. Islam is compatible with democratic principles. The religion itself is a democracy. The truth. A democracy is a system in which all people are judged as equals before the law, regardless of race, religion, or gender. The vote of every individual counts as much as the vote of any other. The collective will of the people then determines the rules of society. Under Islamic law, only Muslim males are entitled to full rights. The standing of a woman is often half that of a man's, sometimes even less. Non-Muslims have no standing with a Muslim. In fact, a Muslim can never be put to death for killing an unbeliever. The Islamic State is guided by Islamic law, derived from the Quran and Sunnah. A body of clerics interprets the law and applies it to all circumstances, social, cultural, and political. The people are never to be placed above the Quran and Sunnah any more than man should be above Allah. It is somewhat debatable as to whether there are any states in the Muslim world that qualify as actual democracies. There is no denying, however, that the tiny handful that are often held up as democratic nations are ones in which deep tension exists because the government and religious leaders, as the latter, often complain that democracy is an idolatrous system imposed on them. True Islam openly rejects democracy.
How dreadful are the curses which Islam lays on its faithful! Besides the fanatical frenzy, which is as dangerous in a man as rabies in a dog, there is this fearful fatalistic apathy. The effects are apparent in many countries. Improvident habits, slovenly systems of agriculture, sluggish methods of commerce, and insecurity of property exist wherever the followers of the Prophet rule or live. A degraded sensualism deprives this life of its grace and refinement, the next of its dignity and sanctity. The fact that in Islamic law every woman must belong to some man as his absolute property, either as a child, a wife, or a concubine, must delay the final extinction of slavery until the faith of Islam has ceased to be a great power among men. Individual Muslims may show splendid qualities, but the influence of the religion paralyzes the social development of those who follow it. No stronger retrograde force exists in the world. Far from being moribund, Islam is a militant and proselytizing faith. It has already spread throughout Central Africa, raising fearless warriors at every step. And were it not that Christianity is sheltered in the strong arms of science, the science against which it had vainly struggled, the civilization of modern Europe might fall, as fell the civilization of ancient Rome.
There is a growing misconception that Islam is the fastest growing religion in the world. A misunderstanding that followers have converted to the faith, this is entirely incorrect. Ask anyone you know to find out if they know anyone who had wholeheartedly converted to Islam. You would be hard-pressed in finding any. The truth is quite simple. The UK population is being outbred by Muslim immigrants. A typical British family will have at most 2 children on average, if any at all. The concept of the modern-day family is far becoming a dream due to the increasing cost of childcare and housing. As for Muslim families, on average, a couple will have at least 3 children, with at most having up to 5 or more. That's at a ratio of 5 to 1. Statistical projections conducted by the respected Pew Research Center said in the next 15 years or less, we will see a 5-fold rise of Muslims in Britain. Another projection suggested that in a few years, that there will be more Muslims in the UK than in Kuwait. Considering these facts and taking into account how young non-Muslims today do not consider marriage or children as a top priority, and you've got a domino effect, an unstoppable tidal wave that looks to unbalance the UK's demographics. Here is a short video which explains in detail how fast Muslims are outbreeding non-Muslims.
According to research, in order for a culture to maintain itself for more than 25 years, there must be a fertility rate of 2.11 children per family. With anything less, the culture will decline. Historically, no culture has ever reversed a 1.9 fertility rate. A rate of 1.3, impossible to reverse, because it would take 80 to 100 years to correct itself. And there is no economic model that can sustain a culture during that time. In other words, if 2 sets of parents each have 1 child, there are half as many children as parents. If those children have 1 child, then there are 1/4 as many grandchildren as grandparents. If only 1 million babies are born in 2006, it's hard to have 2 million adults enter the workforce in 2026. As the population shrinks, so does the culture. As of 2007, the fertility rate in France was 1.8, England 1.6, Greece 1.3, Germany 1.3, Italy 1.2, Spain 1.1. Across the entire European Union of 31 countries, the fertility is a mere 1.38. Historical research tells us these numbers are impossible to reverse. In a matter of years, Europe as we know it will cease to exist. Yet the population of Europe is not declining. Why? Immigration. Islamic immigration. Of all population growth in Europe since 1990, 90% has been Islamic immigration. France, 1.8 children per family. Muslims, 8.1. In southern France, traditionally one of the most populated church regions in the world, there are now more mosques than churches. 30% of children ages 20 and younger are Islamic. In the larger cities such as Nice, Marseille, and Paris, that number has grown to 45%. By 2027, 1 in 5 Frenchmen will be Muslim. In just 39 years, France will be an Islamic republic. In the last 30 years, the Muslim population of Great Britain rose from 82,000 to 2.5 million, a 30-fold increase. There are over 1,000 mosques, many of them former churches. In the Netherlands, 50% of all newborns are Muslim. And in only 15 years, half of the population of the Netherlands will be Muslim. In Russia, there are over 23 million Muslims. That's one out of five Russians. 40% of the entire Russian army will be Islamic in just a few short years. Currently in Belgium, 25% of the population and 50% of all newborns are Muslim. The government of Belgium has stated one-third of all European children will be born to Muslim families by 2025, just 17 years away. The German government, the first to talk about this publicly, recently released a statement saying, "The fall in the German population can no longer be stopped. Its downward spiral is no longer reversible. It will be a Muslim state by the year 2050. Muammar al-Gaddafi of Libya said, "There are signs that Allah will grant victory to Islam in Europe, without swords, without guns, without conquest. We don't need terrorists. We don't need homicide bombers. The 50-plus million Muslims in Europe will turn it into a Muslim continent within a few decades." There are currently 52 million Muslims in Europe. The German government said that number is expected to double in the next 20 years to 104 million. Closer to home, the numbers tell a similar story. Right now, Canada's fertility rate is 1.6, nearly a full point below what is required to sustain a culture. And Islam is now the fastest growing religion. Between 2001 and 2006, Canada's population increased by 1.6 million, 1.2 of those, immigration. In the United States, the current fertility rate of American citizens is 1.6. With the influx of the Latino nations, the rate increases to 2.11, the bare minimum required to sustain a culture. In 1970, there were 100,000 Muslims in America. Today, there are over 9 million. The world is changing. It's time to wake up. 3 years ago, a meeting of 24 Islamic organizations was held in Chicago. The transcripts of that meeting showed in detail their plans to evangelize America through journalism, politics, education, and more. They said, "We must prepare ourselves for the reality that in 30 years, there will be 50 million Muslims living in America. The world that we live in is not the world in which our children and grandchildren will live." The Catholic Church recently reported that Islam has just surpassed their membership numbers. Some studies show that at Islam's current rate of growth, in 5 to 7 years, it will be the dominant religion of the world. As believers, we call upon you to join the effort to share the gospel message with the changing world. This is a call to action.
Don't get me wrong. Childbirth is a blessing, and every family should be allowed to have as many children as they want, with the understanding that they are able to financially support their families. The problem lies with what their children will be taught by their parents. Muslim parents will ultimately teach their flock about the evils of the West, how poisonous British law is, and encourage them to stick to their own kind, this being primarily Muslims. In fact, studies have shown that Christians and other religious groups are less devout than Muslims. What this means is that present and future Muslims are less likely to apostatize from their quote-unquote religion.
تنطلق من بيوت الله عز وجل وما أدراكم ما المسجد المصنع الأول الذي يخرج الرجال على تقوى من الله ورضوان المصنع الأول الذي يخرج المجاهدين المسجد هو حياة المسلمين وعنوان عزتهم وكرامتهم الجنين الفلسطيني في بطن أمه، المسلم الفلسطيني أو المسلم، الجنين المسلم في بطن أمه في كل العالم ينادي أن الوحدة يجب أن تكون على تقوى من الله ورضوان، على خيار الجهاد، على خيار المقاومة.
Multiculturalism is a way of life in the UK, whether you like it or not. We have established an immigration system to support a thriving diversity program. Unfortunately, within a few years to come, the common non-Muslim citizen will soon be outnumbered by registered UK Muslims. Only then, Islamists will demand Sharia law overrule British law, as Muslims will be in the majority.
Arguing that some British streets have become off-limits to non-Muslims may be a view associated with the far right, but when a Pakistani-born Anglican bishop publicly agrees, it reopens the debate. Writing in the Sunday Telegraph, Michael Nazir Ali says the effect of multiculturalism has been to turn already separate communities into no-go areas.
Our history is based on our Christian understanding of the world, that we've built a country on this basis, but in the past decade or so we seem to have lost it. We've emphasized multiculturalism to the point of losing our own roots.
In Oxford, the city of dreaming spires is also adapting to the new cultural landscape. The local mosque wants to broadcast the call to prayer over loudspeakers, another feature of multi-faith Britain which the bishop objects to. Different religions living side by side may result in occasional cultural friction. The alternative would be the creation of single-faith ghettos, which so many people fear or oppose.
Even though we're not quite there yet, the future does not look too promising for the UK. If we don't act now, our way of life could soon become history. Muslim groups will soon begin to virulently target citizens on the streets, businesses, and anyone who dare oppose their diabolical agenda. We have seen Muslim clerics incite hatred against our own women, proclaiming that modern women conduct themselves as pieces of meat. We have heard clerics call for babies to be clothed in burqas lest they face sexual molestation. Under Sharia law, Muslims will enforce the rule of amputation of criminals' hands, which leaves no room for rehabilitation and reinsertion back into society. We already see a tremendous amount of women in burqas throughout the UK. Not only is the burqa a sign of oppression, but a constant security threat. We've all heard the reasons for the burqa, how Islamists purport the beauty of submission to God by covering beauty itself. As contradictory as it may sound, the burqa is a constant security threat. Police are unable to identify wanted criminals or to record a perpetrator's face at the scene of a crime in the event that they might take advantage of wearing one. Today, police do not have the right to ask a woman to remove her burqa in the event that they may be searching for an area for a suspect. The Muslim woman will demand to have her burqa removed in the sole presence of a female member of the police force in a secluded room for identification purposes. A Muslim woman like this can and will most likely take legal action against the police department for discrimination and harassment. In reality, the police department are powerless against such taboos. But the glaring hypocrisy is that non-Muslim UK citizens with their own religious beliefs are now becoming targeted and vilified in their own workplace. You may have heard of the recent legal problems British Airways faced when they fired a female employee simply for wearing a small crucifix necklace. Yet we are force-fed to accept and to silence our criticisms of the burqa and other Islamic headdresses in fear of being prosecuted with a hate crime. The fact is that our nation has a plethora of religious artifacts and heritage sites that contain crucifixes and Christian symbols. That tourists from all over the world pay thousands of pounds to visit these places to experience our grand history and culture. Do they get offended? Absolutely not. And why should we? More to the point, why should we remain silent? If religious symbols offend these cowardly and corrupt individuals, then why don't we remove our proud Union Jack, as ultimately the flag was derived from the St. Andrew's Cross, a Christian symbol? Very soon, true followers of Islam will begin to demand the removal of provocative women's wear, bikinis, lingerie, jeans, and unisex clothing. citing that such a power was not only distasteful but offensive to their beliefs and their God. The problem lies not only with Muslim teachings, but with the clerics who vehemently enforce Sharia law on young, impressionable Muslim men. These oversexed individuals, with absolutely no sexual outlet, as sex before marriage is not permitted, have been taught that British women, and also Muslim women alike, who dress the same, are no more than pieces of meat. Such a mindset has led to multiple gang rapes in Australia and is a regular occurrence throughout Asia. This disgusting and demeaning act has now hit our own shores. Only recently have we heard about young girls under the age of 18 in the north of the UK being groomed as sex slaves. Pedophile rings are common among Muslim communities, as their own clerics have declared sex with a minor, whether she be 6, 9 or even as young as 1, is permissible. Of course, a Muslim man must be married to her, but why wait? We have seen the emergence of honor killings. No doubt you would have heard about the young Muslim girl who was supposedly kidnapped and murdered. To the nation's surprise, the perpetrators were no other than her own parents. The parents suffocated and strangled their own flesh and blood to hide the shame that their own daughter had assimilated into the British way of life.
Shafilia Ahmed, a 17-year-old schoolgirl murdered by her own parents. Why? Because they thought she was becoming too westernized and were ashamed of her. When her body was found early in 2004, Iftikhar and Farzana Ahmed played the part of the devastated parents. A picture of grief and innocence, they appealed for help.
I mean, we just wish somebody could tell us what happened to her. We appeal to the public, if anybody knows anything, to come forward.
But they knew exactly what had happened. They had killed Shafilia with their bare hands, using a plastic bag to suffocate her. The little girl they had nurtured had rebelled against her strict upbringing. Months before she died, the teenager had filled in a housing form, saying she wanted to move out because she feared she would be married off. Shafilia's body was found near Kendal in Cumbria, 6 months after she was murdered.
Well, with me now is Detective Superintendent Geraint Jones.
In 2008, the case was featured on Crime Watch.
Clearly someone has gone into some length to dispose of Shafilia's body. I can't see that being a stranger. Someone connected to Shafilia has done that.
The finger of suspicion has long pointed at her parents, who kept up the lie, even turning up at a news conference to protest their innocence.
They strenuously deny any direct or indirect involvement in their daughter's untimely demise. If called upon to do so, they will not hesitate to defend their good and unblemished names in any court in this land.
And the lie held for 7 years until another of their daughters came forward with the truth. 23-year-old Alicia Ahmed gave evidence from behind a screen in their trial, telling the court she had seen both her parents suffocate her sister and then wrap her body up in bin bags. And it was that damning evidence which finally saw the Ahmeds convicted of murder.
If there is one thing that we pray will come from this, it is that her beautiful face and tragic story will inspire others to seek help that make them realise that this kind of vile treatment, no matter what culture or background they are from, is not acceptable, and there is a way out.
Nearly a decade on, we now know that this girl was killed by the two people who should have loved her the most. Danny Savage, BBC News, at Chester Crown Court.
We have seen attacks on homosexuals, peacefully going about their business, only to be confronted and accosted by a group of Muslim men who had threatened the young man for simply walking on the street, proclaiming that the area was for Muslims only.
Mate, don't you know this is a Muslim area? Look at your, what's wrong with your face, mate? What's wrong with your face? Why are you dressed like that for? Why are you dressed like that for?
Why are you bothering me? I'm not.
Because you're walking through a Muslim area, dressed like a fag, mate. You need to get out of here.
I am getting out of here.
Yeah, get out of here quicker then. Get out of here quicker then. You're dirty, mate. Look at your shoe. Yeah, I know you. Did you say you know? Admit you're dirty.
Dirty.
Are you dirty? Say it again.
I don't know. Like, who do you think you are? Like, really?
This is Muslim area. Get out of here, mate.
You're such a man.
Get out of here, mate.
You're such a man.
Yeah, you're a gay, mate. Get out of here, mate. Get out of here, you fag. Get out of here, mate. You bloody fag.
Muslim area. Okay? Alcohol, bad. This is a Muslim area. No drinks in this area, it's a Muslim area.
Okay.
What is? It's a Muslim patrol. We Muslims, we patrol the area, forbidden munkah, forbidden evil. Alcohol is evil. No alcohol, yes? Have a good day. It's a Muslim area.
Right.
Obviously no alcohol is allowed in this area.
Right.
So unfortunately you're going to take the alcohol.
We don't care if you believe it or not. Then you need to control this area and you need to forbid these people from dressing like this and exposing themselves outside the mosque. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Remove yourself away from the mosque. Go away from the mosque now. Muslim patrol. Muslim patrol. Don't be allowing her to puke outside the mosque.
This is Muslim area.
Do you understand? Do you understand what we're saying? It's a Muslim patrol. Muslim patrol. Move away from the mosque.
Move away from the
mosque. Move away from the mosque now. Okay? Do you understand?
This is democracy. This is freedom. This is secularism. We clearly need Islam. Move away from the masjid.
Go away now. Don't come back. Don't come back.
Don't come back.
Keep your mouth closed.
Do not consume alcohol. It is haram for your own necks.
We don't respect those who disobey God. We don't respect them.
I'm so appalled.
We don't care if you're appalled at all.
Muslim patrol.
And Mary, it's Great Britain.
This we don't care. It's not so Great Britain. Not so Great Britain. Do you understand? Vigilantes implementing Islam upon your own necks.
And Miss Mary, it's Great Britain.
This we don't care. It's not so Great Britain. 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 Not so Great Britain.
Suffice to say, Sharia law is completely opposite to our own laws. It is against our way of life. Every UK citizen has the right to live how they wish to live according to the laws, which have been in place long before Islam ever arrived on our beautiful shores. As a respected and venerated president once said, "A house divided cannot stand." Abraham Lincoln, a pioneer and champion for people's liberties, for common sense, for the security and prosperity of his own nation, fought for his own people's right to free assembly, to live safely and peacefully in the sanctuary of a great and mighty free republic. Hopefully we can take a leaf out of Honest Abe's book, especially when it comes to the issue of security. The question which would perturb most people today is, why would a young Muslim man create a homemade bomb and kill and maim hundreds and thousands of innocent civilians? Men like Muhammad Sadiq Khan, Shehzad Tanweer, Jermaine Lindsay, Hasib Hussein, the bombers responsible for the 2005 London terrorist attacks. Men like Nick Riley, a Plymouth resident and Muslim convert who attempted to blow up a substantial portion of the Princess Hay shopping centre in Exeter. The reason is jihad.
There was a couple of reasons. The first and foremost reason was due to my education in psychology and my pursuit in a career in mental health, I was dealing with a lot of people who are suffering, you know, people who are self-mutilating, cutting themselves, suicidal ideation, you know, all kinds of, you know, mental and psychological disturbances. And so I saw a lot of suffering and I thought about them and I thought about a lot of, you know, just general humanity. And I thought about, you know, what Islam, you know, says about them in general, that their lives are a waste, because they're not you know, bowing to Allah five times a day, saying stuff in Arabic and growing their beards, and their women aren't wearing hijab, as if that is the purpose for why God created them. You know what I mean? And on top of that, that their destiny is going to be, as chapter 4, verse 56 says, that their skin is going to be burned off and replaced with new skin, endlessly. An actual physical, endless torture that they're going to go through. And I think it was a combination of putting all of that together that opened up all of the other issues that, for example, that I've been reading about and even debating about with you guys and other people, you know, stuff like Abdullah ibn Abi Sa'd and you know, Zainab's marriage to and the satanic verses, and, you know, the list could go on and on about the controversial things about Muhammad ibn Abdullah and his companions. But that was the big thing that came at me, was understanding the intense indoctrination. Literally, it's probably the most intense and most disturbing indoctrination that exists on our planet today, and it gets people to act violently and viciously and oppress people and want to implement Sharia law. This is what this type of indoctrination does. Even if you think that we can reinterpret Islam, we can, you know, Islam can be reinterpreted in a peaceful way where we can focus on all of the positive verses, there is still a massive element there, and there's plenty of verses in ahadith to support it that get Muslims to do crazy things. And everyone sees it. I mean, even the Muslims sees it. They're just turning a blind eye to it because they're emotionally attached, like I was, you know, to their identity as a Muslim. And here's my message to the Muslims is that, look, I understand that you're emotionally attached and that you have this love for your religion, but there is so much else about Islam that's detrimental to broader humanity, and that there needs to be a movement of people speaking against an idea that's very dangerous for society. And I didn't realize that until recently. And you know, to be liberated from it, I could only want that for so many. Even, you know, when I see Muslims now, you know, as an apostate, I see these bearded guys and these women wearing the niqab. You know, before I used to be like, mashallah, you know, they're so much into the deen. I want me and my wife, my Sunni Muslim wife that I wanted, you know, I want to be like that. You know what I mean? And now when I see it breaks my heart. You know, even if they convince themselves that this is, you know, that this is good for them, you know, even if they think that it's good for them, you know what I mean, it still breaks my heart to see them, you know, being lured by this ideology when they could be so much more of a human being than that.
What exactly is jihad? And jihad means holy war, or to wage war on those who are presently occupying Muslim land and to enforce and impose Sharia law on the citizens of that region. It is the duty of every Muslim to defend their land and to attack the perpetrators. But how does this apply to the UK? As many Muslims will rhetorically say, the Quran preaches peace and to respect all cultures. This is no more than an unpopular misconception and a typical incorrect knee-jerk response by Muslims to cover up their true intentions. Much like the other misconception that terrorism has occurred in the UK and the USA because of poor foreign policy with the Islamic States. What people seem to forget, despite all the conspiracy theories of 9/11, it was fundamental Islamists who brought us into a 10-year war with two Muslim countries. It has been a monumental tit-for-tat calamity that has never ceased. The die-hard terrorists of 9/11, who were revered and cheered by the Islamic world, are now venerated as the Magnificent 19.
Jennifer, Yasser Arafat may issue this condemnation. Look at this. We're seeing people applauding, clapping, smiling.
We're only following what their quote-unquote religion demanded. Jihad.
This is the moment a vehicle bomb detonates in Kabul, Afghanistan.
The real meaning behind jihad is conversion, and by that I mean conversion by the sword, or thug-style subjugation by acts of terror. East London Muslims in areas around Tower Hamlets have now completely taken over that region and now consider their enclave as Muslim territory. Hence the call to jihad against non-Muslim UK citizens. And with the emergence of Islamic vigilante groups throughout the Tower Hamlets, it is evident that it has already begun and will soon become a regular national occurrence.
Remove yourself away from the mosque. Go away from the mosque now. Muslim patrol.
Not out of ignorance and misguidance of the Quran, as many Muslims will say, but out of Muslim obligation and, more importantly, loyalty to their clerics. Muslim clerics like Abu Hamza, a virulent UK naturalized citizen who abused our marriage laws to obtain citizenship and to go on to facilitate and organize the London terrorist attacks in 2005. A true Muslim who our own government could do nothing about until the USA intervened because our own laws had stifled us to the point of stalemate. In relation to counter-terrorism, according to the Huffington Post, the United Kingdom's budget and expenditure for 2012 was £2 billion. And now with government cutbacks, it is said that our defences are slowly diminishing. And yet, hate crime laws prohibit concerned and scared citizens from speaking the truth, for voicing their concerns about their own country's moral and security integrity. In speaking up to address these issues, will label you a racist, a bigot, or an Islamophobe. When the glaring irony is that our own citizens do have phobias. They are scared of an outdated medieval doctrine which is slowly infiltrating our legal system and choking our citizens' right to free assembly.
There is a major effort taking place to curb free speech in this country, irrespective of our Constitution or Bill of Rights. And free speech advocates say the United Nations has come down on precisely the wrong side. The United Nations has adopted what it calls a resolution combating defamation of religions. The United Nations now wants to make that anti-blasphemy resolution binding on member nations, including, of course, our own. That would make it a crime in the United States if the United Nations were to have its way to criticize religion, in particular, Islam. Kitty Pilgrim has our report.
The UN General Assembly is considering a binding resolution urging member states to make it a crime to criticize Islam.
What they would do would be to make it illegal to put out a movie or write a book or a poem which somebody could say was defamatory of Islam.
The so-called anti-blasphemy resolution would call on governments to pass their own laws to determine what can be said about religion in public. The resolution urges states to provide, within their respective legal and constitutional systems, adequate protection against acts of hatred, discrimination, intimidation, and coercion resulting from defamation of religion. But the U.S. says the concept of defamation of religion has another meaning. While appearing in name to promote tolerance, the implementation of this concept actually fosters intolerance and has served to justify restrictions on human rights and fundamental freedoms. Even talking about the influence of Islam on terrorism could be called criminal under this resolution if adopted by an individual country.
You are entitled to say that in America. But not if the UN has its way. They would criminalize that kind of practice, and they are trying to do it elsewhere around the world.
A group of 57 Organization of Islamic Countries, the largest bloc at the United Nations, has been pushing it out of concern, it says, over anti-Islamic behavior, saying, "This resolution is a major step towards sensitizing the international community on the serious impact of defamation of religions." Last December, the General Assembly passed it as a non-binding resolution. And this year, a binding resolution is expected to be introduced as early as March. Human rights activists say its influence is already being felt.
There have been a number of prominent cases, most recently in India, for instance. The editor of a newspaper was charged for reprinting an article that had initially been printed in the UK.
While the article mentioned the three major religions, Christianity, Judaism, and Islam, the editor was arrested for, quote, hurting the religious feelings of Muslims.
Now, essentially what this resolution would do is to urge countries to pass laws in their country, which would be unconstitutional in the United States, and basically violate the spirit of many Western judicial systems, Lou.
Yeah, a couple of questions. One is, of those 57 nations supporting this resolution, how many of them are democracies?
I couldn't tell you, but many of them are Islamic countries. Pakistan has led the charge on this and has tabled this resolution.
So they're not democracies, and they're fascinated with their own precepts about what would constitute the way to run a nation, not like ours. Is there any discussion, or perhaps of simply, if the United Nations insists on doing this, sort of bulldozing the building, getting it out of the way, and letting them go find another place to live?
It wasn't really discussed in my discussions today.
Well, perhaps we can raise that as an alternative to impinging on our constitutional liberties. Kitty Pilgrim, thank you very much. Appreciate it from the United Nations. What a place. Well, joining me now with more on the UN effort to stifle free speech, to squelch it, really, is Christopher Hitchens. He's Vanity Fair columnist. How dare these people attempt such a thing?
Well, first, thank you for having me back. And second, look, the claim of Islam is that it is the last and final revelation from God to humanity. That's quite a big claim to make, that you don't need another book after the Quran. You don't need any more evidence, you don't need any more argument, that it's all done for you. Now, that's okay if people want to claim that, but now they want to say, if you have any difficulty with this idea, if you have any doubts about it, you're not allowed to express them. Because if you do, you are insulting us. You're making us feel hurt. Now, just imagine those two claims put together. One, a fantastic claim, and the other, a fantastic claim that you can't challenge. That is totalitarianism defined. It's a rape and butchery of the First Amendment of our Constitution.
It's also being joined, though, Christopher, by a lot of nations that are not Islamic, and there seems to be a strong a move forward, and it's already, in point of fact, been approved at this level by the United Nations. I have to say that we're reaching a point in the United States where we've got a group of people who will go around clucking, saying, oh, yes, this will be just fine, irrespective of our constitutional rights, because there's some, you know, we have Americans now. There is a movement afoot in this country for hidebound orthodoxy of all sorts of extremes, politically, religiously, in which people say, you know, the heck with the Constitution, there are higher issues at
order. No, you're quite right about that. I mean, when Salman Rushdie was sentenced to death by a senile theocrat in Iran for writing a novel, the Archbishop of Canterbury, His Holiness the Pope, certainly the Sephardic Chief Rabbi of Israel, and many other religious figures, joined with Khomeini, not in exactly endorsing the fatwa, the death sentence, but in saying the problem was blasphemy, that they agreed with the Ayatollah to that extent. The problem was not the destruction of free speech and free expression, but the hurt feelings of the religious. But when you clear away all these discrepancies, there's one overwhelming thing that's happening, and it's this. There are Muslims who are prepared to use violence at the drop of a hat if a cartoon is published in Denmark, if the Pope makes an off-the-cuff remark, a stupid one in my opinion, about Byzantium or the Crusades. They go straight to violence, but yet you cannot criticize them for being violent lest you be accused of blasphemy.
The United Nations is getting a bit burdensome, it seems to me, to anyone who's interested in freedom, whether it be through the World Trade Organization, whether it be all sorts of institutions, organizations, ranging in issue from global warming to anti-blasphemy.
Yes.
This is becoming a totalitarian, authoritarian organization. And political correctness is really an effort to control, seemingly to me at least, nothing more than an effort to control thought.
Universal human rights exist whether religion recognizes them or not. And we have to stand up for this.
Yeah.
And we have to better start standing up for it now, I would say, against theocracy.
Well, I have to say that my patience is ending primarily with the United Nations that's arrogant enough to think it should leave us subservient to its collective will.
We should not have to bend our laws, alter our culture in any way to accommodate a foreign and insidious doctrine which theoretically is still living with the mindset of that in the Dark Ages. Islam is a culture of barbaric violence. It is a mindset so ingrained into the Muslim psyche that no one dare question its intentions. As mentioned before, these are the hallmarks of a mass cult mentality. Take, for example, the recent film, The Innocence of the Muslims.
Every non-Muslim is an infidel!
You're only for me.
An accurate account of the life of Muhammad, which enacted scenes taken directly from the Quran. Consequently, after the film went viral on YouTube, citizens predominantly of Pakistan, a virulently oppressed and zealous Islamic country, of which, ironically, the UK has the greatest amount of Muslim expatriates from, rioted on the streets, burning shops, attacking police, and destroying their own local cinema. The mentality of Muslims is that our films and entertainment industry are always sanctioned by the government and represent how the government wishes to publicly show itself. The core concept of freedom of speech, democracy, is foreign to Islamists. Islam and democracy are like water and oil, they do not mix. Burning shops, rioting, murdering, all because of a poorly directed movie, is this the mentality of sane individuals? In the UK, we have documentaries made which question our own beliefs, whether it be Christianity, Darwinism, or other. Yet because we are a civil nation with civil laws, and more to the point, we are a democracy where we have the right to express our own conjectures without fear of reprisal. To put it bluntly, Britain is not accepting of such a violent mindset. The proof is in the pudding. Whenever a country adopts Islam, it eventually tears itself apart. Take a look at Afghanistan, Pakistan, Egypt, Syria, Iraq, Iran, Tunisia, the list goes on. Whenever parliamentary elections are held after citizens have gained control of the country again, the majority vote always goes to the hardline Islamic party. Not out of love for the Quran and obedience to God, but out of fear. Hence, another cycle of oppression, subjugation continues until another spring occurs. It's an endless cycle of uncommon sense that has been happening for hundreds of years. The question more appropriately is, why would an extremist Muslim, or any Muslim for that matter, move to a country which is completely opposite to its own culture? A country which laws are far removed from the society that they grew up in? People have blamed the free welfare entitlements of governments gone by for the increase in immigrants, predominantly from Asia and Muslim regions. While there may be some element of truth to that conjecture, the truth and real reason is unknown to millions of UK citizens. The key word is caliphate.
ومن هنا الفتح بعون الله سبحانه. تأكدوا اخواني. يا اخواني انتم الان امام لحظة تاريخية. امام لحظة ربانية في دورة حضارية جديدة ان شاء الله. في الخلافة الراشدة السادسة ان شاء الله.
From what you may have learned by now, the core obligation of every Muslim is to usher in Sharia law, and to do so quickly and by the sword. What further entails is that a Godhead type ruler and enforcer of the book must be ordained by the Muslim world to oversee their agenda and to subjugate all non-believers and Muslims. This leader is called a caliphate, and in the world of Islam, the caliphate is God.
حلم الخلافة الإسلامية حلم أرض الخلافة يتحقق بإذن الله على يد الدكتور محمد مرسي ومن معه من إخوانه وجماعته وحزبه. رأينا الحلم الكبير الذي نحلم به جميعا. الولايات المتحدة العربية. الولايات المتحدة العربية ستعود تكون عاصمة الخلافة. ستكون عاصمة الولايات المتحدة العربية هي القدس إن شاء الله. تكون عاصمتنا ليست القاهرة ولا مكة ولا المدينة وإنما القدس إن شاء الله وسيكون هتافنا على القدس رايحين شهداء بالملايين على القدس رايحين
شهداء بالملايين
على القدس رايحين شهداء بالملايين على القدس
رايحين شهداء بالملايين على القدس
رايحين شهداء بالملايين على القدس
رايحين نوري ولن نواري ولن نداهن. نعم هدفنا القدس سنصلي في القدس أو ننال الشهادة على أعتاب القدس.
The caliphate will almost only be a cleric or imam and will force us to obey and pay homage to Allah and his corrupt child molesting prophet Muhammad, hence bringing us to bow under the pseudo-religion's true name, Islam, or submission. What is right now a free-loving liberal country with civil laws and a modern perspective will become ultimately a totalitarian fascist world where freedom of speech and lifestyle will be abolished, swiftly and without debate.
And how's the campaign to move Britain over to Sharia law coming along?
Well, this is in the hands of God. We do our best to propagate Islam. Well, of course it is. I think many people will see that democracy and freedom is no good for the British, no good for Afghanistan, and in fact, we need an alternative. Unlike man-made law, the Sharia is not something which gives you a right today to take it away tomorrow. It's good in all times and places.
To make this an issue of freedom and democracy is absurd. Anjum, you haven't had a hair on your body touched by this government or this country. You haven't spent a day in prison. You haven't suffered one bit for your views. You're allowed to sit here right now because of freedom and democracy. In your so-called caliphate, you'd have me killed, wouldn't you? Wouldn't you have me? Am I an apostate that deserves death?
Well, I mean, obviously, Majid Nawaz is part of an apostate organization called the Quilliam Foundation. He's paid by Alan Johnson and Gordon Brown to say what he's saying.
Anjum, so how many surprised. Thousands of pounds a year do you get
this,
on
this
benefits?
Man gets £2 million with his and his organization in order to fight against Islam and Muslims.
Look, he's asked you two questions. Firstly, under your caliphate, he would be executable, would he?
He would be judged by an Islamic judge, and then after that.
And his second question. His second question. Did you hear that?
Repeat the second.
How many thousands of pounds are you receiving from the British government every year on dole money? Are you on the dole? Are you on the dole?
At the end of the day, when you lose the argument, it's very easy.
So now I'll ask you again. Have you had a hair on your body touched by freedom and democracy?
For both of you, obviously, and the 5-minute clip that you played here, I'll tell you something. All of you are in one camp, the camp of non-Islam, against the camp of the Muslims.
So what's the verdict on those in the camp of non-Islam?
What the Muslims out there will see is that you have already played a clip 5 minutes long.
Do we deserve death?
In order to demonize the Muslims, there's a bunch of lies told by Mr. Anjum. Watson in that clip. It will take me 5 minutes at least to refute all of those.
Do we deserve death?
And on top of all of that, you
is
have
our
a juncture
in origin
yourself
here for you to take?
Propagating what the government wants to do.
Can you answer any one of
and
my
at the end of the day,
we're not getting,
you can gang up on us as much as you want. Ultimately,
we're not getting
Islam will prevail.
I want to ask you, just a second, hang on a second. What is gained by banning an organization? You may think he's talking nonsense, but what's gained by stopping him talking nonsense?
On this very show,
a lot of money by Majid Nawaz.
On this very show, I opposed the government in banning Hizb ut-Tahrir. There's a clear difference, even though that was government policy at the time. And the difference is that there are over 20 members or affiliates of his group that are serving in prison on terrorism offences. I met members of his group in a Lashkar-e-Taiba training camp in Pakistan. These people describe the 9/11 attackers as the magnificent 19.
We've got the list.
Well, no,
these people believe. These people believe
to say that the
blood
by the government. That's the only reason he's saying.
Anjum, allow me to finish.
You cannot deny that there are, as he says, members of your organisation convicted of crimes. Serving sentences
in
prison. Yeah,
and why were they convicted? You have people in prison. Wait a second. No.
So you just denied it, now you admit it.
No, wait a second, Jeremy.
That is
the Britain that we live in today. It is an apartheid system. The Muslims are treated as such.
It's an apartheid system.
You need to wake up. You need to wake up to the reality. I'm not being
at least you're not executed.
You need to wake up to the reality of the situation.
If I'm judged an apostate by a Sharia court judge, will I be executed in your caliphate? Answer that question.
You know very well that you have left the deen of Al-Islam because you side with enemies
answer
of Islam
the
against the Muslims.
As a judge,
The one who stands with them is one of them.
So will I be executed as an apostate?
You're not going to answer the question, right?
Well, it's a ridiculous question. He knows the answer to it already.
Well, the public don't know the answer to the question, do they?
A Muslim caliphate will control all Muslim lands and will use the Quran to dominate the world. Without sounding religious, some scholars may say such a man could be referred to as a type of antichrist. Now you may be wondering why there has been past violence between Muslim, Sunni and Shiite tribes throughout the Arabian region. The reason is both tribes are fighting for succession and succession alone. When Muhammad died and after a majority of the Muslim world had apostatized, Abu Bakr, Muhammad's father-in-law, waged wars known as the Ridda Wars on the apostates, forcing them back into the faith. Once Islam had reared its ugly head again, Muslim leaders demanded a caliphate to lead. the right of succession was fought between Muhammad's father-in-law and Muhammad's cousin, and therefore we have in-house fighting in Islam today. Whichever tribe and whoever wins will take control of the Quran and ultimately an Islamic-controlled world. Whoever wins rules. Whoever wins will be God. In conclusion, what will this mean for you and I? Under Sharia law, you would immediately see the following effects take place. Goodbye any homosexual artists, musical or actor, and idolatrous British television shows. Goodbye Freddie Mercury, Elton John, Little Britain, Coronation Street, EastEnders, and more. Goodbye iconic British monuments such as St. Paul's Cathedral, Buckingham Palace, Westminster Abbey. Goodbye to our proud monarchist traditions, our Sunday bells, our bacon and eggs. Say goodbye to provocative women's clothing, of which women have every right to wear. Say goodbye to lingerie, bikinis, pop music, or even posters of such things. Say goodbye to independent and successful women. Say goodbye to fair and just nuptial and child custody courts. Say goodbye to your pedophilia laws and the legal age of consent at 18. And finally, say goodbye to the pork industry, as well as the adult film industry. There are many more things we enjoy and take for granted that will be eradicated once the so-called peaceful, just, and beautiful Sharia law tightens its grasp on Britain. But most of all, and most importantly, say goodbye to your freedom. Hopefully by now you fully understand the implications of such a diabolical mindset and how Islam is no more than an aberration to the British way of life. But it's not for me to decide. This is a legal matter to be investigated thoroughly by the lawmakers of this land, using in reference the statutory laws which have been in place since the birth of our great nation. Therefore, to combat this insidious cult, I have drawn up a preliminary legal proposition on behalf of the sovereign nation of Great Britain for a safer and freer UK. Firstly, it is in our best interests as British citizens and British first to permanently remove and abolish Sharia law courts from our land. A wise man once said that a servant cannot serve two masters. And likewise, it is a ridiculous concept to have two legal systems established in the UK that oppose each other. Furthermore, we have the right to question where our lawmakers' loyalties lie when discriminative statutes have been created to suppress the UK from questioning Islam and wearing religious symbols of faith. The key word here being religion, which Islam is not. Secondly, we must as a nation demand our leaders invoke a national and legal inquiry using our constitutional legal system into the content of the Quran, especially in regards to sex slavery, bigamy laws, domestic violence, and honor killings, to determine with the inclusion of the teachings of Islamic clerics and their core text, to probe their true agenda and to investigate if the cult of Islam violates our legal statutes protecting our citizens. If ultimately it is found that even in the slightest, even if one verse does violate our laws, and poses a danger to UK citizens' civil liberties, then it is in our best interests to ultimately ban the Quran and Islam from the British Isles. During this time to take preliminary action, the government must invoke a national ban on Muslim groups handing out Islamic literature and to stop public proselytization. Consequently, if the inquiry does in fact determine that the Quran does violate our democratic laws, even in the slightest, then ultimately we must demand new laws to be set in stone to ban Sharia law by constitutional declaration from ever being established in the UK ever again. We as UK nationals and as taxpayers reserve the right to demand our governments uphold the legal right of UK citizens to carry or wear whatever religious symbols, apparel they may wish to, as long as their religion is not a threat to the UK and is in fact a religion, not a political system. it is an absolute violation of the Discrimination Act to allow Muslims to wear burqas, but to forbid Christians, Buddhists, Hindus, Sikhs, and other religions from wearing their own religious symbols and apparel. We must demand that the government remove halal taxation, as the majority of UK citizens are not Muslim and should not have to pay towards a cult movement that has no bearing on their life. We must demand stricter visa processing and tougher citizenship tests. This applies to non-Muslim and Muslim alike. The government and Department of Immigration must inform and enforce the law that successful applicants are obligated to integrate into British society and to swear a pledge of allegiance to Britain solely. Any new citizen who violates the terms and conditions of their citizenship, namely with anti-British hate speech, is to be charged with treason, revocation of citizenship, and ultimately deportation. New citizens must renounce any affiliation to Muslim extremist groups. New citizens must abide by a 10-year probational program. If they are found to be conspiring in any way, whether it be attending an anti-British rally, meeting at a mosque or house with the agenda to conspire against the security of the UK, will ultimately lead to revocation of citizenship. This proposed hardline ruling is in fact now a reality in Holland and has been pushed hard to be imposed on cowardly Muslim thugs to keep their country safe. Furthermore, it should be demanded that premeditated attacks on British soil and citizens will and should ultimately lead to the reintroduction of the death sentence. We must demand that new citizens recognize that they are now British and British first, that all businesses and shops should have their storefronts written in English. After all, this is Great Britain. These are precarious times, and true Muslims are taking advantage of our financial distractions, our growing apathy, and detrimental libertarian groups who are ignorant of the true Muslim agenda. I have made this video not out of fear-mongering, but to alert you to the actual status of our country's freedoms today. The truth is that Islam's own doctrines and policies vilify itself, making it impossible to stomach. Yet, ironically, it still remains here in the UK. It is a desperate unit of thugs and malicious individuals posing as holy warriors clinging onto the democratic cloth of Great Britain. They are desperately trying to overthrow our quote-unquote man-made laws and invoke the quote-unquote holy laws of their God. If we were to take a national survey from every non-Muslim man, woman, and child in this country as to whether they approved of Islam's presence in this country, Muslims would be supremely outnumbered. The choice is yours. You can sit idly and watch your great nation swallow itself in political correctness, or you can use this video as your voice. If you love your country, if you fear for the safety and prosperity of your children and grandchildren, you will make a stand. It is the right of every man, woman, or child in this great nation, whether you are a Christian, a Hindu, a Buddhist, or a Sikh, or even an atheist, you have the right to stand up. This is your country too. If you love what your flag stands for, you will help this video go viral. Share this video with as many people as you know. Post it on Facebook, Twitter, blogs, bulletin boards. Send it to your local television station. Write to your local minister. You will demand the government address the aforementioned issues. The more views this video gets, the greater the chance we have of having our voice being heard. After all, you are a proud citizen of one of the few countries in the world with a proud heritage of democracy, and we are not living in a completely fascist society yet. But if you don't act soon, you will be. The choice is yours. I hope you make the right choice.
Upon this battle depends the survival of Christian civilization. Upon it depends our own British life and the long continuity of our institutions and our empire. British Empire and its Commonwealth last for a thousand years, men will still say, this was their finest hour.